actually start talking about the different types of research, types of experimental design, excuse me. There's three main types: pre-experimental designs, true experimental designs, and quasi-experimental designs. We'll learn that the pre-experimental designs aren't really good designs to use, so we don't want to use those in any of our research studies or projects. True experimental designs and quasi-experimental designs are only different in one main way. True experimental designs must have random selection and random assignments to groups. They must have that. Quasi-experimental designs will not have random assignments. They should have random selection if possible, but they will not have random assignments of groups. Meaning, again, random assignment to groups is where you have all your subjects, you've selected them randomly, then you randomly select, you say you have three groups, you just basically close your eyes and randomly put them in groups. So quasi-experimental designs will not have random assignment. In the following slides and in the textbook, we have some notations that are going to be there, so I want to make sure we're all clear with what these different notations mean. So each line within the notation equals a group of participants, so it equals a group. The R letter equals random assignments of the participants to the group. O's equal the observation or a test. That's where we actually measure the dependent variable. The dotted lines equal groups were used intact rather than randomly assigned or formed. So they were just put in groups. They weren't randomly assigned to groups. Capital T equals the treatment or their experiment was applied. That tells you that's when they actually went through whatever the experiment was. If you have a blank space in a line where the T appears on another line, that means that was the control group. The control group will not go through an experiment or their treatment. And the little numbers or the subscript, that equals the order of observation and treatments. And they can be in order. We do one before two, obviously. So that's what a subscripted number or a little number means. The first type of designs we're going to talk about is pre-experimental designs. We have three different ones. We have the one-shot studies, and as that the notations there shows, we do a treatment, whatever that may be, and then we measure it. This one we have not a very good design because it doesn't control for any of the internal threats, the threats to internal validity. One that's used quite a bit here is the next one is the one group pre-test and post-test. So we have an observation, we pre-test them, that's what the O means. We do some kind of experiment, then we post-test them at the O2. It's pretty common, but the problem with the one group pre-test, we don't really know if that treatment had any kind of cause and effect. Did that treatment really cause the dependent variable? There's just too many threats to internal validity to really say that the treatment caused the effect. So it's not a good design. Then the static group comparison, which is we have a treatment, and then we measure that in two different groups. So we're trying to do a control group here. But what the dotted line means, again, is that the groups are were used intact. They weren't randomly assigned. We don't know if those two groups are equal to one another. And we don't really know if they were even equal at the beginning. Because since we didn't do a pretest, we don't know what kind of change happened. So the book talks and says that the pre-experimental design is just not a good design because they do not control for any of the internal threats to the validity. We're going to move on to actual true experimental designs. We're going to use this example research question null hypothesis for some of our upcoming experimental designs and quasi-experimental designs. So our research question is, how will different exercise programs increase muscular strength of 18 to 25-year-old male college students? Our null is there will not be a significant difference between the exercise programs and increasing muscular strengths of 18 to 25-year-old male college students. So one of our independent variables is exercise programs, and our dependent variable is muscular strength, and we're going to measure that using a bicep curl. Just made it up, so it's pretty straightforward. So our first example of true experimental designs is called a randomized group design. And so our groups are randomly formed. So we selected and assigned our subjects to random groups. In this first one, we have two different groups. And what we're trying to determine is the differences between the two groups, group one and group two. And so our top line is our experimental group, and the bottom line is the control group. So the experimental group would do the treatment, whatever that treatment may be. What we're going to say for our study is the group, the treatment is going to, they're going to do 50% of their one repetition max, three time with 10 reps for a 12-week period. So that's the treatment, 50% of their one repetition max, three times, times 10 for 12 weeks. Then at the end of those 12 weeks, we will measure their bicep curl strength, where the control group doesn't do anything during that 12 weeks. And then we run statistics to determine what's the difference between those two groups. That's one design, the randomized group design. Then we can extend this design a little bit more. It's called the extending the levels randomized group design. Now we have three groups. We have two experimental groups, same research question. So research group one, their treatment was the same one, 50% of one repetition max, three times 10 for 12 weeks. Then our second group does the treatment of 70% of their one repetition max, three times 15 reps for 12 weeks. And our third line is the control group. Since there is no T there, that means they do nothing during that time. And so then we can see if there's a difference between 10 reps or 15 reps. The second group should do 70% of one repetition max, three times 10. I wanted to change intensity, not frequency. Okay, so group one does 50% of one repetition max, and group two does 70% of one repetition max, three times 10 for 12 weeks. Now, what's the difference? This, So our next type of true experimental design is called pre-test, post-test randomized group designs. And so again, our groups are randomly selected and randomly assigned to groups. In this one, the groups are given a pre-test. So with our study, they would be given a bicep curl one repetition max test for both the experimental group and the control group, because we're on the top part of the slide, we only have two groups. And so the purpose of the pre-test, post-test random design is to determine the amount of change over time. Did the experimental group change more than the control group? And what we use is we're going to use the difference or gain score to determine if the groups experienced a change. The post-test scores minus the pre-test score is typically how we find that number. We use a group mean score for the post-test minus the pre-test group mean score. And we come up with that final number, and we use that final number, the mean difference score, in our statistical analysis. And again, so with ours, we do a pre-test of the bicep curls, one repetition max strength. We have them do the experiment, just like we talked about earlier, 50% of their one repetition max, 3 times 10 for 12 weeks. At the end of the 12 weeks, we do a post-test, one repetition max again. The control group didn't do anything. Experimental group did the study. And then we compared the differences between the groups. Did the group get stronger? Did the experimental group get stronger than the control group? Well, we would hope so. We'd hope that that's what would happen. Then another way we can do the pre-test, post-test is where we do repeated measures type study. Where this one, we have randomized groups. Again, we randomly selected them. We randomly placed them in groups. We do a pre-test. We have two groups in our example here on the bottom of the slide. The experimental group and the control group do a pre-test. We'll do the bicep curl and one repetition max again. We do our treatment, and let's say we do it for 12 weeks again. Whatever number, 50, 60, 70%, whatever one you want to use. We do another test. We're going to say we'll do it 12 weeks. Then we do another treatment. We can either adjust the number based on the score in the past, or we just use the same number. It depends on your design and what the whole question is. We'll for our example, we'll just maintain them at the 50% of one repetition max, the original one repetition max, for another 12 weeks. The control group does nothing during that time, and then after that last 12 weeks, we measure them again. They're one repetition max as a group, and then we calculate the different scores again, and we compare the values to one another in the end. So that's the pre-test, post-test, randomized groups with repeated measures design. Now we can extend this even further, where we have pre-test, post-test, randomized groups with repeated measures, so we have another group. So now we have three groups. We have two experimental groups and one control group. And so with this one, kind of similar to the extending the levels in the randomized group design, where now we have two control groups. We'll do with one control group, with the first experimental group, they do 50% of the one repetition max, and the second experimental group would do 70% of their one repetition max. This design can either be similar to the pre-test, post-test, the first one up here, where we have three groups here at the top, where we have two groups do the study or do the treatment once for 12 weeks and measure them, and also have a control group. Or we can do repeated measures, where we have them repeatedly measure over a few times during the study. So both of these are good designs, or all three of these, four of these are good designs, as we're looking for change. And the reason why we have the control group again is because the control group shouldn't do a thing. And so that way we can say that the experiment was the cause of the change in the strength. For our example, it was the bicep curl testing or exercise that we were doing that was the cause of the strength change. Another design is called a Solomon four group design. This one, we combine randomized groups and pre and post design randomization. The purpose is to determine whether the pre-test affects or interacts with the treatments. This is a pretty powerful design, but it's impractical because the number of subjects is needed. Because you need four groups. You need three experimental groups plus the control group. So if we do 30 per group, that's 120. I'm not going to talk about it too much more because it's impractical and it's not going to work well. Quasi-experimental designs. What is used? Quasi-experimental designs are used in real-world settings, and we try to control internal threats to validity, even though we use real-world settings. We use this more in our kinesiology area because it's just the way it works. We're not going to be able to do things in laboratories most of the time, and for a program like this, most of our, if we're going to do experimental designs, it's usually going to be quasi-experimental. Again, the subjects are not randomly assigned to groups. We just got to put them in groups. And sometimes they may not even be randomly selected. If it's possible to random select and do it, but if you can't, you can't. It's about all you can do. So we're going to go over a few of these different quasi-experimental designs. We have a non-equivalent control group design. This is a pre-test, post-test quasi-experimental design. That dotted line again means that the groups weren't randomly assigned to the group. Hopefully they're equivalent, they're equal, they're similar to one another. Hopefully the individual, the researcher has at least selected individuals that are similar to one another. And it's the same thing as our true experimental design. We have a pre-test and we do the experiment, our 12 weeks, 50% of one repetition max, 3 times 10 over 12 weeks. Then at the end of the 12 weeks, we post-test them. We have the experimental group and we have the control group. We can have two experimental groups. We can have with a control group. The only difference is, again, those groups weren't randomly assigned into those groups. And again, hopefully, they're equal groups. The subjects are normal or equal to one another. Reversal. Let me go back to this real quick. This is, if anybody is doing the research in this type of research experiment in the research program, typically going to be this design. This is a good design. So the next design is called reversal design, and this design is used quite a bit in the school settings. And what we're trying to do with the purpose of this design is to, and I put in each bullet there, is that the purpose is to determine a baseline measurement. So we have a baseline measurement, then we give them a treatment, and we're looking to evaluate the change between the treatments. So observation 2 and 3, is there a change there? And then we want to evaluate when we pull away the non-treatment time, is there a change? Then we give them another treatment and to see if there is a change. Then we stop the treatment and evaluate the return to a non-treatment condition. So let's look on this figure 18.1. So we have lines A, B, and C, and D, E, and F. We have the dotted line for T, that's the treatment, that's the experiment that's going on for both of these. Then the O's down at the bottom are their observations or your different test for them. So the very beginning we got O and 1 and 2. The baseline is O1. O2 is just another observation. You haven't done anything yet. Then you can give them the treatment. The very first experiment, whatever that is the T line. And so you can see in line A, they went up, they improved. Line B, they improved. And line C, they improved. But on the other one, in D, the first treatment, D went down. E pretty much stayed similar. They went up a little bit, but not much. F went up a little bit. Then took away the treatment. You can see A stayed the same, B went down, A or C went up. I'm looking at 04. Then on the next chart, 04 again, D stayed the same, E is pretty much staying, is going up a little bit, but F didn't stay the same. We give another experiment, whatever that is, where that treatment may be, and then we measure them at 0.5 to see what that change was like after the treatment. A went up, B went up afterwards, but they're going down, as you can see. C went up again, so there's some kind of change with that treatment or experiment. On the next table, we can see that D went up, so it had some effect after the treatment. This time, the first time they didn't. The first time they went down, the second time they went up. E just keeps going up in a straight line. And then F didn't do a thing. Their change are actually going down just a little bit. And so what this allows us to do is to see the rate of change between the different groups. The next type of experimental, or excuse me, quasi-experimental design is called the ex post facto design. This is like the static group in a pre-experimental design, except we control who's actually getting the treatment. The other one, we don't know what the treatment was. Typically, this is used when we're comparing characteristics of like athletes versus non-athletes, or fit versus a not fit group of individuals. So we give them a treatment, we have a control group and an experimental group. These groups are not randomly assigned, that's the dotted line. We're looking for a variable that can describe the differences between these groups. The problem is that this design cannot answer this question because of the different threats to internal and external validity. It's just not a very good design. It's better to do the pre-test, post-test design. And the next and the last, or excuse me, the next design is called a switched replication design. This is similar to the true research designs, except the groups are not randomly assigned. You can have different levels of groups, so different intensity of our one repetition max. So one would be 50%, two would be 60%, three would be 70%, four would be 80% of their one repetition max. We have repeated measures. That's what all our 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 is, repeated observed measures and treatments on different levels of our subjects. And this design is not used much because, look, it's a lot of work. a lot of people just don't have time to do that kind of designs. Our next quasi-experimental is a time series design. This is used only on one group of subjects, and this study attempts to show that change does happen when treatment is administered, and the group is different when the treatment is not applied. So it's similar to the repeated measures design here, where we have a bunch of observation, then we have a treatment, then we're looking to see what the group is like when we give them the treatment. So A went up, B went up, C went up, whereas D didn't change at all, and that's shown because even post measurements afterwards, they never changed. E is up and down regardless of what you do to them. F is going up regardless of what you do to them. G went up, plateaued, then went back down. And then go back to A again. A went up and maintained it. B went up for a little bit, then went back down, went back to their normal level. And C progressively made improvements. So it's a time series. So each one of those, A, B, and C, and D, E, F, and G, are all different groups. So, and there's also a thing called a single participant, where you only look at one person. This is done a lot in medically, which would be a case study. And you typically use like the reverse design or a time series design with a single participant.